all for coming. I see a lot of very familiar faces in the audience, so I appreciate you being here. This is a beautiful night, right after Tumbleweed Tuesday, which all of us year-rounders love September, but I will not say why.
Right. Be positive, right?
Yeah. No, I won't give away the secret.
Right.
I've known Peter for a while now, about 3 years or more. 5 years. And I'm honored to be talking with him tonight because he is a quality person as well as artist. I first saw his work at Neoteric Fine Art in Amagansett, run by Scott Bluedorn, who's a mutual friend. He's also shown at Out East Gallery with Scott Pitches and Montauk. As well as many other places. I showed his work at a series of pop-up galleries that I did between Sag Harbor and East Hampton based on my online art gallery I started in 2016 called Art Unprimed. I'm now at Guildhall, which I am thrilled about. I've really found a lovely art home on the East End there. And I'm excited to be here discussing Peter and his work. When I saw his work at Neoteric, I was struck by it because I had no idea what it was. it was a certain series of work, and I first found it very intriguing, beautiful. I noticed subtle colors. It appeared to be aged and yellowed, like an artifact. As I approached the work, I noticed small black scratches in the surface, linear marks that ended with an extremely small figure on a surfboard. This little surfer carved the surface of the piece like he would carve the face of a wave. And Peter creates these works by doing exactly that. He carves the surface using a technique called scrimshaw. It was delightful for all of these reasons, and I later found out that these surfaces that he was carving into were made of recycled surfboards. This is a resin surface, if you don't know. The aged colors were from natural processes created by years of use and surfing, as well as the effects of the sun. The compositions are often inspired by the placement of a logo on the board, a ding or a scratch. Sometimes he works directly on a cutout piece of a board, or removes the resin from the surface, collaging it together from different pieces onto a flat surface. The imagery really draws you in for its beautiful simplicity. He has an amazing skill at distilling his drawing into a few simple marks, just enough to paint the picture. It gives you a feeling of the vast body of water that this small surfer is within and navigating, and a glimpse at what that experience might actually feel like. This also runs true in Peter's illustrations and cartoons. He creates a weekly cartoon for the East Hampton Star. Clever and witty, again, he's able to paraphrase and use imagery with very brief text to communicate a moment that is funny and ironic. His illustrations have found the form of products with his company Ditch Ink. And they have new lives as t-shirts, stationery, prints, onesies, and much more. Peter and I spoke with Esperanza León, who I would love to thank for asking me to do this talk today, about how the Victor D'Amico Institute of Art has been a beautiful educational place for artists on the East End. And we really wanted to talk a lot about Peter's trajectory as an artist and educators, mentors, and colleagues that he has worked with along the way who have brought him to where he is today. He has a lot of images to share with us, a lot from his sketchbooks, which is really interesting. You don't normally see that exhibited, so that's really special. And I do want to start off by just asking you a question that some of us may be dying to know, but where do you get your sense of humor? Is this something that was instilled by you, by someone you grew up with, or did it come naturally?
I want to say my dad right away because I just wanted to make him laugh because he was like super serious. He's like a kind of an engineer scientist type. But if but when he showed him something, like a silly drawing or whatever, he was just like this uproarious laugh, I just wanted, that was like a trigger, I wanted to make that happen, and he was just kind of a goofy guy to, anyway, he would like do this funny dance whenever he was in the mood and whatever, but so the whole household was kind of nutty in a way, perhaps, and so I don't know, Casey, when she asked, she said she was going to ask me that, and I was thinking, I guess it's my dad, because he was a nutty guy, and and then I subscribed to Mad Magazine, which I still do to this day, which is really bad. And that's, but it was just, you know, the combination of the wit and the storytelling and the drawing was just like, just knocked my socks off. And I just had no idea how those guys did it. The drawing was so just out there. I just didn't even understand it, how they could do it. So I don't know, I guess that's it. But I just don't like taking too much serious. I mean, I take something super seriously, but I know early, but Case and I were talking about fine art in general, and I said I've also sort of steered away from a little bit because it just seemed a little humorless or it just had like this weight, and it's like, oh geez, you know, is this thing working? Is it like, is there magic happening? Or no, it's a piece of shit. You know, send it away, whatever. It's just like, you know, I just didn't, so I go, all right, I don't know. I don't want to even really do that. But possibly to fault, like I would, but I, of course I loved good drawing and I loved beautiful design and color and this and that, but I found myself frequently kind of torpedoing a perfectly good piece of art with like some bad gag, you know, that like, like if people go, oh, that's beautiful, and they look closer and there's some dumb joke in there that like, I go, oh, what's wrong with him? So, you know, to this day, I kind of got to do it, but I just feel like if you're gonna go to the trouble of creating an image and putting it out there and hoping that somebody reacts to it in some way, reacts at all, pile it on. Just like, you know, I want it to be strong from a distance, and I want it to, when they come close, that it's, you know, there's something worth looking at. You know, like, you know, you go up to it and it's still rich, or there's something more to be found. And if there's some idea in there or a concept or whatever, great. You know, it's the whole image making thing, a single square piece of whatever it is you're holding up and you're expecting for somebody to have some visceral or some effect, it's not that easy to really, so I'm just pulling out all the stops whenever I can. I mean, we're competing with like video people that make these, yeah, these crazy things, you know, music and video and sound. It's almost like it's hard to compete. Like, here, look at my painting. Look at it. You know, it's just, it's almost not fair. It's like, keep them over there. So.
Well, talk a little bit about your background. You were born in Germany.
I was born in Germany. My parents were Czech background. We were refugees. When I was two, we came over by boat. And then we lived on the East Coast for a few years, but then my dad, he was an engineer, like I said, he got a job in Michigan at General Motors, and he'd heard they had a plant in Santa Barbara, California, and he loved to swim. He was like, you know, from Czechoslovakia, but he was always in the rivers and kayaking and blah, blah, blah. And so he's going, we're going to California, and I was great. So we, you know, I was seven when we drove across country and settled in there, and that's where I got my water surfing chops going. My dad was like, get in the car, we're going to the beach, you know, like every day. I had to swim, so that's, you know, I mean, you look at me, you think, oh, that, you know, he's from California, whatever, but it made me that way, I guess, growing up there.
And how did you make your way east?
When I went to, you know, it's sort of a long, complicated story. I don't know how, but let me just go back a little bit. So when I was like in fifth grade, and a teacher of mine said that she just said, you should be an artist. And it was just, Mrs. Phillips, just kind of out of the blue. And I remember she was looking at a drawing I did of like a, it was a spaceship with an eyeball in it, and it's like, it looked like half a turtle or whatever. I just remember that moment, and I go, really? She goes, yeah, you should. You should be an artist. I'm like, okay, got it, yeah, okay. And so then, so I kind of told my dad, and he goes, artist, what are you, nuts? You're gonna, I don't know, but it's funny, my dad keeps coming up on this, and I don't even like, I didn't even intend to, but, and he goes, what are you gonna do? You know, in Santa Barbara, they had selling art on the beach on Sundays. And he goes, that's what you're gonna do? You're gonna go sell there every day? And, which is kind of funny, because that's what we do here. Like, but I go, there's, you know, there's probably other ways. And he had this twin brother who was an architect slash painter slash, he had an Austin Healey, and my dad drove a VW bus. You know, it was, they were like twins, but totally opposite. But he was like a swinging dude, and he wore a leather jacket. And I go, I want to be like that artist guy, you know? It was, that looks good to me. And so, what was the question?
How did you make your way east?
Okay, so I wanted to be an artist. In high school, I kept going at it. And I got encouragement from the right people. They said, keep going. And then I got the gig as the high school cartoonist. And they kind of let me alone and let me do my work. And I go, okay, this is great. But then my dad put me to work in the machine shop, just in case, you know, at a small company. Long hair is getting stuck in the machinery. It was like, I mean, basically nothing has changed in like 55 years with me personally. I'm just saying. So I'm on my way to be an artist, and I go to City College, and I go off to San Diego State to study graphic communication, whatever, just because my grades weren't that great. I didn't know. It just seemed like a good thing to go, and the surf was good there. So I moved there, and it was actually a disaster because it was just the 70s, and everybody was partying, and I just didn't have the wherewithal to sort of just resist it or whatever. And I ended up just dropping out like after a year, and bought a one-way ticket to Hawaii and just went. And my parents are saying, you're doing what? And I go, I'm going to Hawaii and I'm going to surf. Until I figure this out, what I want to do. And I had a backpack and my board, my one-way ticket. My mom's putting canned food in my backpack. And, you know, as I'm going out the door, they're like, I guess he's really, you know, the money, they're stuffing money. So I just flew there and ended up there. I went to Kauai because it wasn't, it was smaller and whatever. And I started hitchhiking, and the guy took me to this one nice, beautiful, jungly part of the island. I went in the woods and made a camp, and mosquitoes just attacked me. It was like just, and it turns out it was like really just awful experience. Well, the locals hated the Californians that went there because you're not Hawaiian. They called you Howleys, and I had a spear fishing, a spear gun and flippers, whatever, nothing. I'm gonna spear fish and I'm gonna live off the fish and I'm gonna do drawings and sell the cartoonists. And none of that worked out, and I ran out of money like in no time. But I did surf, and I surfed a lot, and I didn't like that part. But just every night was just misery, like in my camp. And I had to move camps. Like, people are going, they know where the camp is. You got to move tonight. So I was on the run, and I just really felt like an outlaw for a while. But it was like some kind of weird bad boy camp. You know, it just like, you know, it didn't take me long to go, okay, I don't want to do this. I get it. I don't want to do this. I got a job in the carnival just to get money to get home. Or, you know, I get the job, and within like 4 minutes, they're having me operate a tilt-a-whirl, which is a giant machine. And the decking is spinning. People are screaming. So that's what straightened me out is what happened. So I came back to California. And my uncle, the one who I admired, said, forget that. You need to go to Art Center, you know, which is a serious art school. And sooner or later, I made my way there. I got accepted. I'd spent a little more time building up my portfolio. I got a job in a small ad agency. And I went to Art Center, I got accepted, and then I went to that, and that's like they're tough. It's like, you know, you go in there, it's like boot camp. You don't know, you're no good. You don't know nothing. You have to start over, you know? It's like, we're gonna teach you how to draw. We're gonna teach you the fundamentals, just good drawing, good design, how to paint in gouache, how to da 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 da. It was, and I thrived there, and I did well. And so, so at the end, they have a portfolio review, and you show your work to the panel of people, and they kind of tell you, well, for one thing, they don't let you graduate unless it's like really good, because they don't want to besmirch the reputation of sending out people that are not, you know, employable or whatever. So they said, you need to go to New York, and that's how I ended up here. And I go, okay, New York. And so I was excited about it, but I also like immediately started like calling up, is there any surf out there? And so I was loaded up the pickup truck and headed to New York, got an apartment in Brooklyn when it was cheap. And I left this part out. I had a double major at school because my father's side about how are you going to make a living was always like nagging at me. So I had a double major of advertising design, which was just, you know, doing fake ads, like, you know, the art direction for ads. And so my plan was to be an art director for a while until I could build up my illustration portfolio to finally just be a full-time illustrator. And so I did that, and I finally got a job. It wasn't that easy, but I got hired just because I could draw, because in those days, you'd have to present ads that were done with markers, you know, like, you know, they chose the client, and so I worked on a whiskey ad, and Air Canada was one of my accounts, whatever. But it was just because I could draw. You know, you'd go to these meetings on, you know, how to sell stuff, whatever, and I just sort of wasn't interested, obviously. But I got to the point where I had more work with illustration at night than I was getting paid during the thing. And so then I pulled the trigger and I quit, like, after 4 years and just did full-time illustration. And really just in the nick of time, because the illustration business in the 80s, early 80s, was still viable, which it almost isn't now anymore. But you got paid well. There was a lot of need for it. You know, you would you'd go show your portfolio magazines, and I'd work for all the major magazines, newspapers, annual reports. I did some animation. And, you know, you'd have to go show your portfolio. Then there was no faxes, nothing. And it was like constantly showing sketches, change this, come back, deliver the job. And then finally the fax machine came around, and I remember thinking, I'm gonna get me, it was only $1,600 for a fax machine. And then it was, I don't have to go in, I don't have to show it, I can stuff it in. And then I got robbed like a week later, the fax machine was stolen. It was like super valuable. Like, I was like, I think I leased it, and I still had to pay forever. Anyway, long story short, so it got to the point where you didn't need to go in, and then the computers made it, you know, possible. You could scan art, you could go in, send it anywhere, and you didn't need to live in New York City. And that was, and I was coming out here to Montauk constantly just to, you know, I wasn't really a city boy. It was exciting, I liked it, but I liked it out here, and I could get in the water, and I'm just more of a nature guy, and just, you know, it's like, moved here full-time in like 94, and bought a house in Montauk, and been here ever since, and I still love it, and that's how I got here.
Amazing, love it. Do you want to dive into slides and sketchbook?
Yeah, I'll spare you, I have a bunch of note cards, but I'm not even going to look at them because I think I know what I'm doing here. So I've divided up this into three things. Travel sketchbooks, because that's, to me, was the closest to my art that was not like trying to please like somebody like an illustration job or whatever. And it was just what I did. I drew all the time, just nonstop drawing. And so let's look at some of those, because that was inspiring to me. It'll start right up. This is kind of, so this was a trip I took. I know this is not that big, but
Is this where most of your ideas originate? In your sketchbook?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, where is that damn sketchbook? Here, there's one of them. But yeah, to this day, it's just like nonstop. You know, and if I'm driving when I have an idea, I talk it into my phone. My phone's got a bunch of the ideas. Okay. I mean, these are different ideas. These are like visual things. Okay. So this is a trip I took to Indonesia for, it was Indonesia, Australia, some Bali, this and that. But yeah, when the illustration business was going good, all I did was spend money to go on the trips. I would send out postcards that saying, I'm going off surfing, so take it or leave it, but I'll be back on this date. And you know, they all kind of liked it, all those clients. Oh, he's going surfing again, you know, the bum. But it was just, you know, but I sent out a nice card, and then when I got back, I'm back, and then, so start giving me jobs again, and they did. It was amazing. And I mean, that was just back to that thing about the regular job at the ad agency. You know, I was thinking, well, maybe I should just keep doing this. You know, it's, you know, you got medical, it's paid and for everything. And so I remember sitting down when they told me, you know, well, you need to be here at 9, you got to go home at 5 o'clock and do that. And then you get 1 week off. And well, that is not going to work. So so that's why I accelerated the program to get to be a full-time illustrator quickly. So these are just sketches from my sketchbooks. This is in Bali. This was like, I got to Bali and I go, wow, this is awesome, Bali. And then I go around the corner, here's a big old Ronald McDonald on a surfboard. And I go, no, please, no. It's like, you know, you have this Bali high thing in your head. This, I mean, I know now it's our, everybody's everything everywhere, but. So, but this woman.
Can I read this out
loud?
Yeah.
Yeah, what do I say?
You say, bad drawing, because I'm drawing it from yet another bad drawing, trying to figure out what went wrong. I just keep scribbling on it, how much worse can it get? The hack rears its ugly head.
That's so funny, because I don't even read what I wrote
hack.
Anymore.
Could that expression have come from an unskilled executioner?
Oh, my.
It's great. Yeah. It's so cool.
I don't know what to think about, but, well, it's true. You know, you pile it on. You think, I can fix this, but you usually can't fix it. But this was, so I'm sitting there drawing Ronald McDonald. There's people playing chess, which another story is like I showed some other Indonesians were looking at the sketchbooks. They go, who are those guys playing sketch? Those are cab drivers. They shouldn't be, you know, they're like, we're going to track them down or something. It's crazy. But they ran out. All of the McDonald's employees ran out. Draw me. Come on, draw me. And I'm all, oh my God. And, you know, the place is deserted. There was nobody in. And so I tried to draw her on the spot, and she kind of seemed happy with it. But you know, it's not even my thing. I'm like, you know, but I was like under pressure. I had to put out. So here is just some other Indonesian random stuff. I just put a few things because it can go on and on and on. But this is what you see at the airport when you get in there. Welcome to Indonesia. Death penalty for drug trafficking.
That's like the first. Trafficking.
Yeah. That was like the first. As soon as you get out of the plane, you're going. Yeah, geez, okay. And this is like just the name of some shop. Great name, Aromatic.
Meat shop,
yeah, Aromatic. And this guy, I was trying to find about it was like a telecom office, and I was trying to.
Uh-oh.
Hey. But.
Wi-Fi.
He's just clipping his fingernails while he's talking to him. And I go, well, I guess that's a cultural thing, but like, look, it was just flying all over. It's just, but that's why I love traveling so much. It was just like endless fodder of things to draw and to learn about. And so I took this ferry to the smaller island off Bali to look for surf, and just the sketchiest ride. I mean, it was big swells and it's creaky. Everything's just lashed together, and the passengers are just like this. They got their heads in their hands, and they're like, you know, praying practically the whole time. And but they didn't move, so it was easy to draw them. I just read this. I have to admit something in writing. I no longer have surf fever. Surf desire I have. Fever, no, but I need to accept that fact and stop being troubled by it. Like, I don't know, it was like an hour or two. I was like, all right, I'm good, fine. And I mean, it used to be like all day. Okay, so I can't go forever. Just I rented a motor scooter and it was in with the hordes, just thousands of people on motor scooters transporting. I have a funny Bali story, but I just, I think I have to tell it because it's just funny. And I have an illustration that kind of goes with it. Are you guys okay? Am I spending too much time? All right. So I get to Bali and there's this famous surf spot called Uluwatu, which I'd heard about my whole life. I'm like, Uluwatu, I gotta find it. And so I for some reason I go, I was at a hotel and I didn't have transport, but you could rent a bike for nothing. So I go, I'm gonna ride my bike there and I'm gonna check it out. I'm gonna find it. So I start pedaling and I go, Uluwatu there, Uluwatu, you know, that way. And so pedaling and it's like super hot. I'm just, okay, pedal. And then I see the sign, Uluwatu, but it's in a fork in a road and it's exactly in the middle. There's no like left or right. And so I go left. And I go, because it was kind of downhill, and I knew that it was up on a hill, and I knew it was overlooking a cliff, so I go down the hill, and I see the ocean. I go, it's got to be through the bushes. So I go through the bushes, and all of a sudden, just this rustling and shaking of trees, you know, like crazy. And I go, what the hell is it? And there were apes, baboons, like startled, like, you know, like hooting and like irritated. And I'm like, oh, wow, this is really wild and crazy here in Uluwatu. And so then I back up, and then all of a sudden I go, oh no, ants. I'm like, ants are like crawling on my body, like many ants. And so I'm like, now I'm running retreat away from it and back to the bicycle and have to throw out my clothes. And it's just like, no, but I go, maybe I just can't get to it. Maybe that was such a good secret spot to go, or else maybe I went the wrong way. And so I make my way back and I get to Uluwatu, and I get back to the other road and I pedal. And so people are, as I'm driving by them, they go, water, hat, you help, you need anything, you. And I go, actually I do, I need a hat. And they're all, come on. And so I come in and I'm taking a break and I get water from them and I go, I need a hat. And so they pull out these like old, like caps from, you know, Quicksilver surf hats, whatever, thick, gross, they're all greasy. You know, hot, and I go, no. I go like this, you know, and they're all, I go, I went like this, you know, big and round, and then one of them goes, oh, I got it. And so she comes out, the mother of the boys, you know, and all of a sudden I just sense they were like, you know, they're like kind of freeze for a second. And I go, yeah, perfect, I love it. And so I give it to me, and I put it on my head, and it doesn't really stay on that well, but it was like a coolie type of, like you see in rice paddies or whatever. And so they fashioned some line, they attached to my head, and I start pedaling, and it's right away at trouble. It's like flying up on the wind, you know. People, and then I go by houses, and they just start like screaming and laughter, like, ah, you know, like pointing at me, like, look at the ridiculous American, you know, and the hat flying up, and a bus of school children comes roaring, you know, driving by, just erupting, like hanging out the window, like they're gonna fall out. I go, man, I must really look crazy. And so, this goes on. But then all of a sudden, there's Uluwatu, and I go, okay, screw them. I'm going to. And there's, when I get there's like this big old infrastructure of surf camp and restaurants. It wasn't like the other Uluwatu, which I thought it was. But then these women, they're selling stuff, and they go to me. They're all, that hat, who sold you that hat? And I go, well, down the street. They go, that's not a hat, that's a rice strainer for cooking, you idiot, for cooking. So it was like, you know, like somebody walking down to the colander here. And they go, how much you pay? And I go, so many rupees. Like, oh no, it's like 5 cents. That's what it should have been. All right, so that's that story about that. But I did do an illustration about that because a few days later I got, I'm just going to go ahead and do it since we're there. So I got sick. I got Bali belly, which is just, you just get it for me, just the water differences. It's a fantastic food, but it was like 3 days where I was in a hotel room.
This says Road to Uluwatu, Bali.
Yeah, so I was in there stuck 3 days. Well, I couldn't leave the toilet, I was vomiting, and so I did this piece, which is in Balinesian style of that story, where the me pedaling in Balinesian style with the thing in my head and everybody laughing. So that was that was like 3 days work, because I had the time, I couldn't surf. So anyway. All right, so these are other sketchbook pictures. Oh, I'm sorry, wait, this is kind of important. So these are just the random sketches. That was another trip. There's two merged trips here. Giant fruit bats. You know, I've always been drawn to natural history stuff, you know, and I like you'll see some other pieces, like, well, like that bluefish on that surfboard, which I did back there. That's, you know, it's, I like doing it, and I like getting it right. I like the
anatomical
stuff about it. So I'm just looking at this anymore about it. This was also super awesome. That was, I went to this place of Bill Finnegan, my friend. I don't know if anybody has read that book, Barbarian Days, but he's a, anyway, he wrote about us in Madeira surfing, and there's another trip we took, which we got skunked surf-wise, but we went by Krakatoa and climbed up it, and I happened to be reading the book Krakatoa, which was insane, and you can climb up and you can look in the Krakatoa blew up to nothing, and now another baby one is coming out of the ocean, and you know, there's like giant smoldering rocks. How long ago did they come flying out? And it just says, like, be careful. You know, there's like mountain that way, you know. And it's just such an insane world. But remember this, because I did a scrimshaw piece on that. That was off the bow of a boat. Now, this was a boat trip where you go on a boat and you go to surf spots for 2 weeks by boat. It was like opposite of my Uluwatu thing, where you're on your own and you're looking. This is, you're taken care of, and it goes to this part of Indonesia. So there's a lot of images that I made in the scrimshaw later. Those are just things floating in the water that I collected and drew in my cabin. I would surf, and then I would go off with my fly rod, and I would fish a lot because I like to fly fish. And so, again, you can't surf all day, especially, I mean, I was, I don't know, 50 here already. So so I would go off and I'd find these little crazy areas, like monkeys in the trees, and I did the Tarzan yell, and they got all agitated, like crazy. But I would just cast out my fly, and I'd come up with some crazy fish, like almost every other cast. I would manage to take a picture of it, but it was just insane. And then you'd throw it back, and you just didn't know what you were going to catch. It was really great. This is another story, but this guy didn't have a hat. He had his T-shirt wrapped around his head in a cool way in the super sun, and he tried to sell us this thing, which we didn't know what it was, and we did buy it. It was this big thing. We called it. It said Zuni Ball on it, but it turned out that later we found out that it was that they've set out these things that float that detect schools of tuna around in the water and send the information for the boats to go where they are. And then we bought it and put it on the boat. But there's my hat I bought at TJ Maxx, and I gave it to that guy. I stuck it through the port. And I just said I was... So I gave him about the hat I bought at TJ Maxx for the trip, and I thought about all the different hats I tried on before choosing a hat one, like, careful consideration. There's my hat. All right. So here's a village that I had a little time to spend a little more time than the usual sketch. It was called Telos. Biddle, that's different, though, than where you went. Does that look familiar?
It's not work, but there's only one Telos.
You think there's only one? Mm-hmm. And it was a left mainly, right?
Or? There was tons of breaks.
There was tons of breaks, yeah, yeah. And a Biddle went there, and he said, I went to Telos. I go, no way. And so I sent my drawings to the Surfers Journal, which is, I've worked for them. That's like the, you know, it's a really nice surf magazine. And they go, great, we'll do a piece on it. And my friend Russell Drum wrote it, and I did the illustrations from it, which I just plucked from my sketchbook, and also then made some more elaborate versions of the sketches for it, and it was a nice big piece. And this is sort of just a compilation of all that stuff put together. And I have it in my sack. I'll show you. It's been a while back, yeah. But it was Montaukers and Wallacea, because God, there's so much stuff I've learned on that. There's this guy named Wallace who came up with pretty much Darwinian theory, like before Darwin did, and Darwin knew him and his friends, and Darwin actually said, he goes, what a coincidence, I happened to come up with the same ideas a week later, but he was just one of those guys that just really didn't get the credit. But I read or heard about it in Krakatoa, like he realized that there was islands very close to each other, completely different species that were completely unrelated, that he said the only possibility of that happening was from continental drift, where these things came closer together. Some were Australian-like and some were Eastern, Australia, I'm thinking of it.
LA.
Yeah, right. So, you know, over the years, they came close together, and that was like, so they realized this planet things are just moving around here. So there he is, Alfred Wallace. He's my hero now. And that's that, and there's that, and that's that. And that's just a weirdo sketch from my sketchbook, which I thought I was gonna show you weird sketches from my sketchbook, but for some reason it didn't load up, because I wanted to kind of show you what I naturally just comes out of me, and then what I had to do for a living as an illustrator, which Chris, you know, I wanted to talk about the education part of it, but I really had to, after that, all that art school stuff, and you know, you're great, go to New York, et cetera, I had to start over, really, because I had to learn to draw cute kids, and put them in the situation that I wouldn't think of. It was like I almost started from scratch, and it got, you know, I didn't like it, but it, you know, I had to pay the bills, and so. You know, I did a ton of work for like Scholastic magazine, and for some reason I got the whimsical. Oh, he's a whimsical artist, so he does like, you know. And well, okay, but I'm not really. I'm more like this guy. but whatever it takes, I'll do it. Okay, and I never turned down a job. That was my other thing. I just didn't either, because I wanted the money or because I liked the challenge. Like I was rendering Cabbage Patch Kids heads that were in my basement in Brooklyn that were used on, like, not on the Cabbage Patch Kids, but other side products, and, you know, just weird stuff.
Hats,
Drew
and designed hats?
Well, we do that now for Ditch Ink. My wife over there runs, she wants hats, so I gotta make the hats. Nope, but I'm just saying that, Casey and I were saying that I don't like being a snob or whatever you want to call about this. I'm happy to put my image on all kinds of stuff and get out there in the craft fairs, and you know, there is something to be said about managing your career so that, you know, you're repped and they don't even talk to you and the prices are high or whatever, but I just go for it, and I for better or for worse, and that's just the way I am, and I'm enjoying it, and I'm lucky that I really feel grateful that we can do this out here, and that people seem to enjoy what I do too.
Make that shift from having to do more commercial things to focusing primarily on your own work?
Luckily that illustration business kind of forced me to come up with like my own business, because the computers coming out made everything really cheap suddenly, like stock art was used, and you just, you know, and the work just dried up, and it's really tough for illustrators nowadays, so uh, that's, so I go, all right, I'm going to start my own thing completely. I'm going to invest in myself. I'm not going to grovel for work. I'm going to come up with images and things that I'm going to, I wrote this tiny little book on surf etiquette called Wetiquette, which was just an illustrated funny little thing. And that was like our first product in Ditch Ink. And it kind of grew from there, and then greeting cards and t-shirt designs and this and that. And I just wanted, you know, I didn't have to rely on or sitting around waiting for people to hire me, which was good. So then the fine art thing with the scrimshaw, I just never separated the two, but Scott Pitches from Out East Gallery just said, I want to do a show with you. And I'm like, of what? You know, my cartoons? Maybe he goes, just your stuff, your sketchbook drawings. And I go, okay. And so I that was it. And it got me going. And thanks to Scott for doing that for me.
Yeah. And your scrimshaw started when you were given a board to produce on. That's
right,
a great story.
Okay.
Scrimshaw.
Yeah, and talk a little bit about that process. I think it's
can you
very
tell them? Well,
sure.
Because you know.
Yes, I
yeah,
do.
Yeah. Well, I'm looking for this. Just while I'm trying to find this. 1 second, and I'll elaborate on it.
Can I talk about the story? Sure.
Yeah. Yeah. Go. Oh, the story that I was about to tell.
Well, a part of an auction. As a part of an auction, Peter was given a board to produce art on. And he was thinking about the archivalness of the work and will it last? How do I permanently mark on this surface? And eventually he decided to scratch into it. And as he was scratching, and then he rubbed ink in the scratch marks, and it proved to be a really great process of getting his line work onto resin. So it just sort of went from there.
Yeah.
Isn't scrimshaw carving on ivory?
Well, that's what it was. Yes. It was done by seafarers or even further back, Inuits, you know, Alaskans. Yeah. They would do it in walrus tusk, the Indians in bone. It's just a way to, it was like what I went through the surfboard. How are we going to get a piece of art drawing on this thing, you know, to become one with it? So you scratch with, my tools are in there, but I have, you know, a bunch of super sharp or even needles in a holder. You scratch on the surface of I started doing it on surfboards. That's what that whole board is made out of.
Scrimshaw.
So you, you can pass this around if you want. This is a piece of surfboard fiberglass, which I peeled off and then did it on there. So you scratch into the surface, and then you put a flashlight low because you can't really see what's happening. You transfer, you know, I transfer on a design with like carbon, whatever. And then you rub ink into it, and the ink only goes into the lines and wipes off everywhere else. And so, I mean, they did, it was just a way to make a lasting image, but what I like about it, especially on surfboard, is that the scratches that are in the board anyway take up ink, and it so adds like a richness. Right away you feel like you got something that's been around forever.
Is he an Inuit or is he from Bali?
I found a photograph of somebody some Nova Scotia, I think he was, whatever. And I just did a sketch of him. Right, I did the sketch of him, and then I did it on fiberglass right there. But so
do you seal it after?
You don't need to seal it. It's just, you know, I started doing it on. I kind of went around it the long way, but you can do it on bone, which I do it now. Where is that? I think I lost my knife. I sometimes use oil, I use India ink, and now I've been mixing India ink with Sumi ink because it's really black.
Oh yeah.
And so I'm just looking for, I have a pen knife, which I do it on. I've been doing it on knives, which have bone on it, and I don't know where I put it. Oh, here it is.
That's great.
This pocket, but. So there's, you know, this is like, since I've been doing those boards, I'm all, look at this, it's tiny. I don't have to spend a month doing it. Like, so I did, this is just a tiny wave on this, but this is a bone knife, which I found a knife company that makes white bone, and it works on it. And that's the closest to traditional scrimshaw, you know, that you can do. You can't, obviously, you know, I tried to sell something on Etsy, and he made the mistake of, there's a knife that I, that's a, kind of a big roundish knife. It looks like a toenail, and it's called an elephant toe. And so I put elephant toe scrimshaw knives, and they're like, you're cut off. Arrest him immediately.
Yeah.
And I had to write long letters. And,
not ivory.
and I, you know, I said, you know, I'm insulted that you even think that I would, you know, whatever. But I love animals. So that's what scrimshaw is. And so that's what became my so-called fine art. You know, it just takes like, it becomes something that's semi-sculptural, and it's just got a richness to it, and it's going to be around, you know, not like a piece of paper that, so this is just a bunch of examples. I'll quickly go through them, but so the back to that surfboard thing that Casey was talking about, it was for an auction, but for Surf Rider Foundation. Was it like 20 years ago, Arden, maybe? It was a super long time ago. So I thought, okay, what am I gonna do on it? What am I gonna draw on it? And here comes the gag thing again. And I had this whole drawing in my sketchbook that just says, surf art, and it has a picture of a wave on a canvas. And this guy's called Sir Fart.
Sir Fart.
And he's making the art.
He's, did you make it big on that?
Yeah, yeah.
Is there a musical note by his rear
yeah,
end?
Of yeah, of course there is.
Oh, Sir Fart.
Of course there is.
So. Sir Fart by Sir Fart, yeah.
So anyway, so I you know, I took it to the auction.
What year was this? Oh, yeah, about 20 years ago, yeah.
I would say 90, I don't know.
Yeah, surfboard art was like not a big thing.
So Surf Rider was just, which is a great institution.
Yeah,
and they were in the city, and they were starting to get big, and they wanted to, and surfing suddenly turned a corner instead of being like an oddball activity, like a few nuts would do. It became, you know, everybody wanted to be a surfer, and it was good for my business, obviously, because the people wanted surfy images suddenly. So that's what I did on the board, like on this beautiful board, Surf Art by Surf Art, and I thought, this is going to be great. Everybody's going to love it. And so it was like a really fancy auctioneer with the tuxedo. And so, but then I look at all other boards, and they're all very heroic, you know, like, you know, the majesty of the sport, and the beautiful and the like ethereal, magical surf imagery. And I go, oh, this might be trouble. And so the guy like held it up, and he goes, Surf Art by Surf Art, you know, like this. And you could hear a pin drop. It was like, nobody. It was like, like terrible. It was like, all of a sudden I'm like sweating, go, I'm an idiot. What was I thinking? Of course. It was just, you know, but then my friend, I have some friends that like, and they go, we'll bid, you know.
Thank God.
And so they bought it, and it's in their, God bless them, it's in their editing studio in the city right now. But I've seen it since. It's now it would be good. Now people would.
You were way ahead of your time.
I was a little bit ahead, I'd have to say. All right, so here's like, I don't know, I'm sorry it's so small, but that was like that one sketch in my sketchbook that became, that was a board that I had made when I was 20.
Yeah, I showed this piece, and you wouldn't really let me sell it.
No, I didn't want to sell it, because it was
try not to sell this.
Yeah,
like, okay.
But it's a wave, it was
because the board has so much meaning,
right.
And the drawing,
and that's
obviously,
just a cutout chunk of my surfboard. Yeah. I cut it up, because it was rotting, and I...
I also love that. These surfboards have such a huge history with a surfer.
Right.
And when they do break or become unrideable, you know, what do you do with this?
You give them to me like you did. Yeah. Casey gave me two boards.
We give Peter boards when we're done with them. And it's a beautiful way to preserve them. And
the yard, though, is like really not looking very good. It's just like a surfboard graveyard. It's like such a mess.
But if you have any blue ones, they're pretty
fun
colors.
Yeah, the color's good. So I just kind of kept it simple at first when I first started scrimshawing. I just wanted to get like elemental kind of surfing things, like the drop or a turn. I would actually get a big piece of paper, and I'd close my eyes, and I'd think, okay, dropping in, I'm doing this. And then I look and I go, and if it, and it had to feel like right to me, like it was it genuine or was it, you know, so that was, the drop is a huge part of it, you know, on big waves, you're like, that's like.
Yeah, and Peter wasn't just any kind of surfer. He was a big wave surfer, like two-story wave surfer.
Yes,
and you still are, I guess.
We'll see. I'm going on a surf trip tomorrow. I'll let you know how it goes.
Okay, good.
It's been a while. So that one is, I'm sorry it's coming up so small, but that one's opposite. It's going up, and that
back
one.
Up the wave, yeah.
Yeah, so that's just two different pieces of surfboard resin put together. Just, you know, the colors of those old boards are just nice. And and this one was, that one was just like a whole crazy ride, you know, and it, you know, of course there's exaggeration, but there are parts that.
It's such a nice rhythm.
It's got a rhythm, that's nice. Yeah, thank you. That's what, good surfing is, a certain rhythm, a flow. That one, it's just a big bottom turn, which surfers respond to this piece. That's just more the same. This was just a drawing. I should have put this first, but I did like one of the drawings I did first, and then it then explained what each maneuver was and what you did. And
yeah, you have a piece that's a wave diagram or smooth diagram of the moves, and each part of this is labeled A, B, C, D,
right,
F, G.
Yeah.
This is a bottom turn. This is a I don't know.
Somebody just bought that. So I don't have any more. But there's I like that the particular combination of curves. So I did it again on a colored board, and that's the one right there.
That's what I was talking about.
It's almost like
A is a drop in, B is a fade left, C is carve right, D is off the lip, E is pump twice, F cut back, you know, on and on.
Yeah, on and on. And then at the end it says fist pump.
L kick out, fist pump. That's
great. So I thought it'd be kind of neat to do that in noses of boards as like inspiration, like you. This was it's kind of like my first big job of the actual scrimshaw thing. It was a movie that was sponsored by Nike that was about the first black surfer in California in the late 50s. His name was Nick Gabaldon, and there was the movie called 12 Miles North, and he was learned to surf in Santa Monica at this beach called the Inkwell, because that's where all the black people just chose to make it their beach. And the waves was they were beach break there, and he wanted to surf Malibu. That was like, you know, a beautiful long wave. And so he would hop on his board and he would paddle to it, and it was 12 miles.
Wow.
He was like insanely fit. That was him. And that was a poem that he wrote. And it said, the capricious ocean, so very strong, robust, powerful. Can I be wrong? Pounding, beating open its cousin share, comes it clapping, raging with a mighty roar. And then there's a little bit more, which it gets even heavier, but the upshot is that he tried to shoot through the Malibu Pier and he was killed and he drowned. But but the great part about those stories, he came to Malibu and there were all those like famous Malibu surfers then in the late 50s, early 60s, and he became one of them like right away. It was like, you know, he had a great couple of years before that happened there, whatever. So you can find the movie if you want to see it, but I did credits and they wanted shirt designs and this and that. But so I got a 1950s board to try to tell the story on it.
Wow.
Of what happened to him.
The white accents, is that a different
The board
technique?
Was so dark, the board was so old and brittle and dark that the black wasn't stick, was I had to I had to go to the white. I didn't really like it that much, but it's
beautiful.
It just had to, I had to try to get that energy. So that was him riding this big wave and he went straight into the pier there, like.
Wow.
That was a t-shirt design.
So many surfers shoot the pier.
Yeah.
It's
a thing.
Very dangerous thing, but
I tried it once. That's just some. I'm just gonna flip through these, but these are just the cutback, and so there's my bluefish board, which is there, which was it's a detail
that's a great
of it,
detail.
But But as I was doing it, I realized, like, oh, that's why that scrimshaw is like that big. You know, it's like.
I bet.
Because it.
How long did it take you to do
that? I guess it was a month, maybe, right? A month or something like that, or so. So, but it's permanent. It's not come up. But you just, you know, you can't. I don't know how else you would get those lines. It's like printmaking. It's got a look, a certain interesting look, and.
Yeah. Beautiful.
And that worked out. So, and there's that guy, and there's that guy. And this surfboard, I try to use the logo. That's Greg Knoll. His nickname was the Bull. So I put Picasso's Guernica Bull on it. And nobody really got it ever. But somebody did buy that. So.
Darker lines and lighter lines.
How do I do that?
Depth
of scratch, but you know, when I apply the ink, I don't just apply and go, okay, that's it. Sometimes I intentionally like sort of rub harder and keep things, you know, thicker, sort of, or I go double or triple ink in a few places. You know, it's not just put it in, wipe it off, and you're done. It's a lot of back and forth. So.
I love this.
This is, I decided an inside of an oyster would be cool to do on a surfboard.
Do you remember why you did that?
Well, it started because my daughter was helping water testing. Yep. She was doing experiments at the shellfish hatchery of seeing what filters best, clams, oysters, or just shells, like absorbing nitrogen or whatever.
So you made the model.
So I wanted to do the oyster, and so I took a picture of an oyster or opened it up, and it was just hopeless. So I just got to make a model of it. It's like she did use it as in part of her like science project, but it was kind of an excuse for me to make it. But then I could do it. Then it was right, and so that's. It was kind of a weird thing on a board, but it was cool. It was like such a.
It's a female oyster.
Yeah, it is.
And I showed it in a women's show that I did.
Right.
That
was the reason. Part of the reason I made it. I forgot.
Yep.
Totally.
Yep. You were just working on that oyster project at the time, and you were like, female,
right.
Female oyster.
That was right. Was I'm so sorry.
It's a showstopper.
This is your piece. You made it happen.
No.
No,
you made it.
But that one sold, and I really hate selling the stuff that I really like. But this is a swordfish I did.
Great.
Somebody gave me a swordfish bill, so I thought, I'm just going to glue it on. I'm bolted onto the front, and it needs to pop more. It doesn't pop like the bluefish, and I think it's a work in progress for a while. But
it's beautiful.
Anyway, that's, and I want to try the actual scrimshaw on the swordfish. Here's a horseshoe crab, which is just, they're insane. They're so cool. You know, they're just the way they work. And my niece owns that one, so I'm happy it's in the family. This is on Ainsley's wonderful institution, Grain Surfboards over there. I made a board there this last spring, which highly recommended. I loved it. You make a board out of wood, you know, from no plastic parts except for the. But even the epoxy is resin. What's it called, the epoxy? The entropy is, but it's sap, like some kind of sap.
Plant-based. Wow.
So I made that, and that's what I decorated in the bottom of my board, because I don't know, it just reminded me of the bottom of the board reminded me of a thing. There's the top of the board, and it's. But I'm not taking on the surf trip. I'm chickening out, because I don't want it to get messed up.
That's great.
And here's a little hand plane, which is a thing used for body surfing. And for some reason, I just thought it made sense to have like a comparison between the different hands. Don't ask me why, but.
This says chimpanzee and this says man. So
yeah,
hands
just
and
the
feet.
Difference in the hand plane. But no, it's that natural history
part.
Thing I like comes out, you know, where I can see it in some weird museum where people are going, oh yeah, that's right.
So it's accurate that chimpanzee has four toes?
Oh, okay. Well, thumb.
Yeah, tiny
toes
thumb down there.
Go down to the foot.
Yeah, but and then there's that, it's almost
they have like a thumb
it's like toe. Another, it works.
Yeah.
Yeah. And there I just did a gnarly foot on the back of a board. It's like webbed, like a surfer. And there's a There's a board which is now in the Montauk Indian Museum, because that's an Indian looking. I always think about, just think about all the beautiful waves of it over the centuries, you know, like, you know, other peoples, they must have looked at them and go, wow, those waves look good today, and some, they must be good for something, but. That one's very faint, but it's the lighthouse with the guy fishing. And then I started just curling paper up in resin and doing that. And just instead of rendering a wave, why don't I just make the wave? Building. Save some time.
Sculpturally.
It's sculptural. Mm-hmm. And like there. And that's actually the same thing, but then I threw a whale in it, like later. Because I'm always messing with this stuff. And so there's another piece. I was watching a surf contest. I was making that one. It was a commission for somebody's daughter. Yeah, I just cut out a piece of board, pull it up and over. No, I don't want to lose you guys. There's it again.
We are running kind of close to time. Right?
Yeah, I know. So really that's the yard. Is it 8 o'clock?
No.
Just past that.
Just past.
Oh,
seven.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh my God. We could take a break, right? No, don't. Just kidding. This is the chopping up process in the yard. Whenever I have a show, I like hit it hard for like a month. And
yeah, I recognize.
Yeah, right.
Some of the
that's
logos.
That's the swordfish
board,
right there.
Yeah, before you transformed it. I love these.
I know, I like that one too. Which is, I was just trying to make them 3D. It's just, you know, the plain old yellow color of a board thing gets a little. It's just drab, so you get colored boards and you throw in that and it makes it. That's just the pile of various pieces getting done for the show, and they just sort of, I just took a picture because it looked good all piled up like that. There's this, what's the guy that works at Stop and Shop? What's his name? That old
Carl.
There's this, he works there in the freezer department. Do you know him?
Yes, he had a piece in the Guildhall Members Exhibition.
Yeah, I know. He sent me a package of pieces that were, like, crazy. But he bought this piece, and I just thought of it.
Oh,
but he's,
wow.
Like, a big fan, and I just hate taking his money, but I give him a huge discount, is what I'm saying. But he's, I just love it. It's so great that he. Now, here I started getting kind of pop arty. I started, you know, peeling pieces off different color boards and just something else. I don't know.
That's great.
And then I started making round pieces, and Dalene owns it. She's right there. Hasn't delaminated or anything, right? Okay, thanks. Great. what's a little different about this, so that's scrimshot in the usual way, but then I from the behind of the fiberglass part, I sanded away, I ground it so it became transparent behind there. And it was almost like a thick piece of tracing paper where you could see through it. And I was like, wow, this is like an animation cell. You know, animators, they paint the backs. They paint, and so I painted on the back and came up with that sun image, that red on the
backside.
And the white, which is, I'm sort of planning doing more of that, just.
That's really interesting.
Yeah.
And that's how vivid the pigment is, even from behind.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow, that's amazing.
Yeah, so that's on the list of more things to do. That's
this just, is great.
You know, like that one. That was a couple in Colorado bought it because that's like the flag, Colorado's flag, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is it the flag has a big C like that?
Mm-hmm.
Something, but that was big, and that was just now instead of scrimshaw on a surfboard, I found an old dilapidated boat, which I'd on the beach, just a big chunk of it.
Yeah.
It was like thick and white.
Very cool.
And these are just like sketches that trigger things, like, I don't know, that's just
a circle.
Yeah, just things. And there's the guy that came shooting out of that tube. And and here I just was doing it on shells just for kicks. And I do it on rocks too and stuff. So that's that. Okay, so. And I'm going to talk about the cartoons because I get a lot of questions like, how do you go about it? How do you come up with the ideas? So I'm going to show you the step by step because last night they're always due latest, like 9 o'clock Wednesday mornings. It goes to press like 10 o'clock. It's got to be at the printers. And I've gotten the bad habit of like doing this, you know, doing the rough pencil sketch on Tuesday night and waking up at 5 to do the inked person. Just because sometimes I just don't have anything. And I keep thinking, something will come. And then go, nothing comes. Okay, I got to go with this one. So I mean, I'm a procrastinator anyway, but that's kind of how I justify it all. But so I'm going to show you what I did last night. And it's going to be in the paper tomorrow morning. And sneak peek. Show you the stuff. Yeah. Okay, but now I got to find that tiny cursor here. Any questions about any of the other stuff?
The cartoons. Do you own them?
I own them. Yeah, they take them. I mean, he just said they're yours. Just send it in Tuesday, Wednesday, and he doesn't. I think once I had to change something, but the one time. And I hardly ever get complaints. I don't know, some people tell me stop me in the street, but once I did something for St. Patty's Day where I drew a leprechaun on a treadmill trying to get some beer, and he was running a truck, and it said, go green, you know? It was like the leprechaun was on the treadmill trying to get the beer, and I was running the truck, and it was like a Boniker guy in the truck going like this, and I got a livid letter in the paper that it was, like anti-Irish or making fun of the Troubles or something like that. And I was just like, I've done a lot more annoying images than that. I mean, come on. It was anyway, so yeah, they I own it. I just sent them a digital image. That's it. And I'm, you know, they couldn't be greater to work with. I mean, I wish he'd say something now and then.
Huh? How large are the cartoons when you do that?
Well, it's kind of what I'm in the mood. They're best if I can go really big, but it just takes longer, and I do more detail than's necessary. And by the time they shrink down, it loses. It gets worse. It gets muddy. So now I do it about twice as big. You know, they run about 4x4. I do it 8x8 or a little bit bigger. This is... Okay, so I have a, did it come out? What's that? Why am I in there?
You're like FaceTiming somebody.
Hi.
Yeah, there you go.
It's frightening, let's see. So here it is. This is my sketch. I teach cartooning at the Charles Adams Foundation in Bridgehampton, and I always tell the kids, you got to build up your sketches. You know, you do a rough, do very rough, and then improve on it. Put on a light box or a table with glass or window, and improve it, and just keep building it. Because that was something to me when I was young. I would look at like finished illustration, and I would go, "This is just so good. I'm sunk. I will never be able to do that good." You know, and I didn't realize that there was a lot of hard work putting into it, a step-by-step thing. You know, you develop things. If you don't know what something looks like, you go take a picture of it, or else you draw it from the spot, and you look at things. You don't just sit down and do it, which is kind of the impression you get, that you just, yeah, that it just comes out. But it's like, because I really was not that really good. I had a friend that was like really good, naturally good, at 13, and it really helped the both of us, because we were, you know, we drew all the time together, but he was, had a lazy streak, and he still does. His name is Dirk. I bet he's listening. but he had a beautiful line, and smart ideas, and beautiful characters, whatever, and it always kind of drove me nuts for a while there, so I just had to work harder, and that's So that's the sketch. I was going to try to do a Tumbleweed Tuesday cartoon, because, you know, every year I go, I'm going to do a Tumbleweed Tuesday cartoon. I thought I had it figured out this year, where I said, I'm going to have there is no more Tumbleweed Tuesday. It's, you know, it's a myth, you know, it's, there, people are still here like crazy. So I was going to have a three-panel thing where it had a tumbleweed going down the street, and then all of a sudden some like party mobile like driving down it and just smashing it, like flattening it, and then the last thing is a flattened tumbleweed. And I started with the flattened tumbleweed. I just couldn't draw it. It didn't look like anything. It was like, what, you know, what's a flattened
tumbleweed?
Well, that's what I'm working
on
the tick.
On the
so
side?
So I'm, my old standby is something with ticks. I always gonna come up with something with ticks because I hate them, and I'm and I just, while I was literally, I forget what I was doing, but it, all of a sudden I was thinking, yeah, this tour's going away, and I go, yeah, I hope they take some of the ticks with them. That's what I was thinking. And so that was my idea. I'm gonna have people driving, and they're going
home.
They're going home, and they're heading back, and they're the ticks. So that's my pencil sketch. So what I do then is I put it on my light table with a clean piece of paper over it, good high quality paper over it. This is what I teach the kids in the cartooning class, which Ainsley's boys did, and they were great. It's amazing that watching the kids, like 8-year-old kids with these dip pens, dipping and carefully trying to do it. They're all intrigued with it. Because I was trying to teach them the old classic cartoon styles, like Charles Adams style, or work of that thing. So I put it on there, and then last night I actually traced it in pencil one more time, and I put my sketch on my left, and the things that I can't see through very well, like the expressions in the face, I traced super lightly in pencil, and then I start inking. I just ink. So all I'm doing is tracing what I've done the hard work. You know, I've given it structure. Hopefully I nailed the expressions and all that, which I didn't on one of them, and I had to. So now I'm inking it. That's with the light table off. And you can see I did them lightly in pencil, those two people. I really wanted to insult those tourists. I don't know why. I was just kind of had it. So then I ink it, and then that's the inked version. That's what you can see in the paper tomorrow. And it says, leaving is sad, but at least we're getting away from those dang ticks. So he's like, and that one's trying to get in the door, and only the kid sees him. I kept redrawing her because since we're talking about tricks, here's tick-free zone. Don't worry, it's made out of thousands of little ticks that are like.
They're like laughing.
Sorry, I can't see that, but this is, I think, a viable idea. So. The tick situation is clearly out of control, and the cartoonist cautiously submits an idea. Introduce genetically modified ticks that feed only on other ticks into the native, release them into the native population and let them suck each other into oblivion. I mean, wasn't that possible? You know, like tick feeding ticks. You know, it's just like a big circle of ticks, like. Here's a now and then I delve into some commentary in the art thing that said that I was waiting in line at the get my shellfishing permit at the thing, and I thought it'd be funny to have artistic license theory, like, and I was actually thinking some artists really, I mean, you should have a license possibly. Sorry. So she's saying, now cover one eye and draw the reclining figure behind me. And there's all of a sudden I started getting irritated by the curating word. All of a sudden it became part of, like, there was like everything was curating, meals and outfits and whatever. And we have a sailboat in South Lake, and we came there one day, and it was just shat upon. It was like just like covered, like Jackson Pollock,
bird,
you know, like
poop.
Bird poop on it, everything. And so the one bird is saying, the other bird is saying, good show. Who's the curator? This was just around a couple of weeks ago. It's just endless, a take on that old endless summer, because it seemed like a couple of weeks ago, it was like, oh my God, it's just endless. This is some cartoons, people like me to watercolor the black and white versions, and which I do. That's no dogs on beach, and they're in the water surfing and doing everything else, and the guy is, you know. That's a take on the scream about the crowds.
In the water.
Surfing, I made it, yeah, so that's.
He's holding a board.
Yeah, he's holding a board. That's, of course, a t-shirt now, too. He's holding a little clam and going, it's my emotional support clam. That's another hand-colored cartoon. Here I'm really trying to be helpful. stuff you need to know. What to wear in the woods to protect yourself from hitchhiking. Protecting yourself from hitchhiking ticks doesn't mean you can't be fashion forward, and so it's just a crazy outfit, and it's actually kind of, so if you want double protection, wear pantyhose like they do down under for jellyfish protection, which they do. They wear,
oh, really?
There's a deadly jellyfish in Australia that you have to wear a pantyhose, like pull over your head with a hole in the crotch, and for some reason the stingers don't go through. So maybe we need to do that. Anyway, but you know, it's funnier when you read it yourself. I can't read out loud, but anywho. I said, let's get branding because the East End is still hot with no one in sight. So just like, I don't know, Montauk, nutsack, I don't know, talk, duct tape, the end, gas relief, ditch plane airlines, East End plumber's helper, dirt lot tea. Dirt lot is a surf spot in Montauk, but. I don't know, just trying to, this was that, remember?
Oh, right. Yes.
I mean, they're trying to, it's trying to look better now, but it was for, not, it's still terrible, right? And that's kind of, you get off the train, you see it. So I go, hello, it's like a postcard. Hello from Amagansett.
It's from you.
This was during the film festival, just a random selection of rejections and like, flat and forlorn, a surfer's heartache, you know, like no waves.
No waves.
I don't know, you just read them. The rump of Trump, what's behind the man? Pline Air Wars, somebody's like squirting paint at the other Pline Air painter. Oh, yeah. The making of the affair, the senior says good, and blah, blah, blah.
Obesity?
Yeah. that was a Halloween cartoon, everybody was dressed like Trump, you know, the scary. That was when they wanted to do the sandbags in Montauk, so it's like the Amagansett thing. Greetings from Montauk. Can you guys even see back there?
Yeah,
okay.
A little bit.
I'm sorry. But I'll try to say it out louder.
Okay. I think we should also move closer.
Yeah, sure, if you want, but you there's not much left. But yeah, there's. I don't know why some are so small compared, but well, this was. I got not yelled at, but somebody. Was not happy. This was, it was actually the guy from the shellfish hatchery, Barley. He said, you know, they don't, yeah, he's great, sweet guy. They don't want to allow oyster farming in the, over there by Devon Yacht Club out there. You know, they're all in an uproar because they say it gets in the way of their paddle sports and their sailing and they say it affects property value and, so I didn't even bring up the paddle sports and sailing because maybe there's something to that. But so I said, you know, the people on the beach or the house, oh, you're there, pardon us, but you're ruining the view and having an adverse effect on our property's value, you know, yelling at the guy trying to make a buck in the background. But the lady, who's what we know her well, she said, you know, my kids, they can't sail. And I go, but it's massive there. I don't know, there's got to be a solution. There's got to be a... Why don't you make it a race where you have to go around it or something?
The dog is great.
Yeah. Thanks. I mean, it's only a couple months that you can really even do all those things. And so what are we, I mean, does it have to be moved for 10 months? This is that part of ditch called Dirt Lot, which was a surf spot. And I said, Dirt Lot Tower coming soon. Oceanfront opulence. This is just something I saw. Me and my daughter were surfing at the point earlier this summer, and the other side of the point around the corner when I saw these people fishing, and I didn't see the guy in the background, but I saw one guy like pull up a fish, like step on it to get the hook out, and then he just kicked it down the rocks, and it just came rolling, and I go, what a idiot, what a jerk. I mean, that fish is gonna be, because it's too small, so he's like, doesn't give it any respect, and so.
Yeah.
So I had the guy kicking him over, like, after. He says, respect the locals, because, no, it was just like, you know, like, ruined my session back. Like, it was just such a unnecessary, aggressive, ugly act. This is, you know, we're members of that, what's the farm? Quail Hill. So I thought it'd be funny to have a deer dressed up like he's a member, because you're taking more than you're supposed to. Like, and she's go, you're new here, aren't you? So. And this is the Montauk due to excessive demand, town is closed. Please choose an alternative destination. Because, I mean, really, it's almost, you just can't have that many people in there, right? It's insane. I mean, there is this, every restaurant is capacity. It's just, I mean, you just think about the septic tanks. It's just like, it's just not right. It's like, anyway. Oh, there's more. I thought I was done. The squirrels, I think, aren't getting, they should have their signs too, because they're getting smished like every, like daily. So the squirrels are adding on. Yeah. See, I can draw a smashed squirrel, not a tumbleweed, but. And there's the Halloween. She's going, he's a rescue. It's a turkey, obviously. It doesn't get eaten. That was like a different style. Sometimes I mix up styles just because I get bored. And that was with a brush, with instead of a half brush, half pen. So it's bolder and bigger. I did it bigger. This was during all the, like, when all that, you know, the Harvey Weinstein thing. And so this clam is going, hey, nice looking hinge. And she's going, and the clam is going, oh, clam up. The other one. And enough with the shelfies already. Selfies. This was just a couple weeks ago. I can't read all this stuff to you, but it was the upshot was I started being suspicious about all the things they're doing on that Shark Week, you know, where the things they're doing just were, come on, you're just having fun, right? It's like, what are you really learning with that stuff? So I just came up with like crazy ideas for next year. And it says, don't bother dressing it up to look like scientific research because no one's buying it, but shark hugging, great white toe-in surfing where you know, get towed in. Bull shark fighting, like bullfighting, and clasper measuring. Like, you know, clasper is male shark sex organ. So, like,
that's the biggest one.
And then Smelly's Chum Challenge and blah, blah, blah. This one, my daughter, I ran it by her because she does, everything was cringy, you know, to her. Everything's cringy, you know. Oh, don't post that. That's cringy. And I go, all right, well, maybe that's a cartoon. So instead of a girl selling lemonade, she's saying, is your social media cringy? Show me your posts. I'll edit or delete as needed so your children aren't mortified. So with all the parents are lined up, and she's like, she's curating, right?
Curating your social media.
And there I'm back to that weird, okay. Oh, and this one, a lot of people didn't get, including my lovely wife, Art, and a bit, I was kind of mad at her for not getting it. Because she has a dog and she does this every day, but it's a man juggling dog shit. He's like,
bags of the poop
because I was walking the dog and I took the, what do you have something to say, Art? I picked up the bag and I just like flung it and it went like nicely, like soared into the garbage can. I go, wow, that's just, of course somebody should be juggling. See, and of course, no wonder nobody got it.
Bit of a
stretch,
but
he's got a hat and he's got money and he's making money.
On the beach, yep.
I'll take it. Do you have it in Navy? It's like, you know, it's fashion. Everybody.
Fashion surfboard.
And this was when stand-up paddleboarding was, you know, frowned upon in the beginning. Like all the surfers were all, you suck, you know, stand-up paddleboarding. So I thought that stand-up paddleboarders need to hate somebody too. So they're going, I hate those freaking gondoliers. And this, now these are not so much cartoons or gags, but they're illustrations for East Magazine, so it's more bigger, blown up, and it usually it has to do with the topic of the issue. And this was what was the topic? Parties. Yeah, no, it was about social life, parties on the party life. And so there was that party going on, and then I got the fisherman on the beach with his own little party with his dog. That's what you're talking about, right?
Is it watercolor and it's inked with watercolor?
It's just an ink drawing. I do some modeling with color pencil, but then I scan it, and then I just do it on the computer.
It's digital. Really interesting.
I was wondering,
You know what? I used to do airbrush, or I used to do trying hard to get flat color with watercolor. I just don't want to do the digital, but it is a palette of color, and it's just the way to go. It works, and I'm not sweating every single thing I do because I can't fix it. It used to be like you ruined so many things, or I'll send it in where you weren't happy with it. So, you see, there's like a colored pencil, water, and pen ink drawing. But this was, last year, it was end of winter, spring is here. So the guy's in the lighthouse throwing off his clothes because that's what it's all about, right? Getting rid of those winter clothes. And that's what I thought. This was the secret side of the Hamptons. So this was a woman stand-up paddleboarding and Squid is also stand-up paddleboarding underneath her.
The other way.
Just like a mirror image. And this was about the article about Frank Mundus, that shark, you know, that the Jaws character was based on. And I just wanted to draw shark surfing. So that's. And this I did for Biddle when he was, he still is involved in East, but he kind of walked me through this one. You were telling me you wanted the, there was an expression you said, the something of the transportation, like the hierarchy.
My idea was a tidal wave of sort of transportation and humanity crashing on the East End. So there's the lighthouse on the right. And that wave is filled with buses and trains and people. Right.
Airplanes. Helicopters.
Tons of people. It's like the beginning of summer here.
Right. Right. Yeah. But for a while we were looking at a pyramid because you mentioned the hierarchy or something of like how you get there, like the rich people.
Right.
Yeah, like, you know, the wealthy people. Right. And then you got the train at the bottom and then you got the helicopters. And so it sort of is a pyramid also of, you know, like.
There's a socioeconomic message.
Right.
Right. Yes, that's right. I forgot about that.
Yeah, and then it developed. And this is just a take on, you know, old Saul. Who saw the show here? I hope everybody saw the show. The drawing room was like just depressingly good. He's such it's so good. Yeah, Cyril's, rest in peace. I put. And there's a self-portrait, and that's the end of the show. There I am painting, not drawing for a change, but that's watercolor where you build up super slow layers on layers and layers, and I can control it. It's like slow. And
why a chicken?
Because my nose is like a beak. It's a rooster. It's not chicken, it's a rooster. And I like those big things hanging off. My nose look funny. Anyway, that's it. So. Okay. Thank you. Any questions? Anything you want to add?
No, I think
you covered
everything.
Yeah, Meredith.
We have a piece of yours that's not scrimshaw or cartoon.
I know.
And it's.
It's kind of a painting. It's an ink drawing. That was just like a one-off. Well, that show was like. You're supposed to do something different that was, if I recall, was a politically incorrect show.
Yes.
So I did the Montauk Lighthouse on the end of a finger like that. And they snapped it up.
I just wanted to say that it's lucky for you that you never worked for me.
Really?
What? I own an ad agency and I would have made it work for a while.
Really?
I do this on the side.
Oh, damn.
For at least a decade or so.
What ad agency?
Genetino and Meredith.
Oh, nice.
You worked on ShopRite, Chevrolet, but especially WNEW-FM, that would give you that account.
Oh, great. I would have taken it. No, I enjoyed it. I liked the problem, the making of it. It was...
What agency?
First was called Ogilvy and Mather Partners. No, but Partners. It was a small one. It was like a boutique shop where... not huge accounts, but smaller, slightly smaller than need more special attention. Then McCaffrey McCall, which was well known for its so-called country club atmosphere. And it was, you know, I immediately, like, when I got the art director job, I bought my first pair of leather pants, and I, like, was rocked the whole art director. Because my uncle, my dad's brother, he wore leather pants. And I was like,
that was cool.
Anyway, so yeah, no, it was a good, I learned a lot. I mean, there's those old ad guys could draw like demons. They were amazing drawers. Huh? Yeah, yeah, all that. No, I had, like, I got that job there, and somebody was, a woman in my group was dating Seymour Quast, and Milton and him were, they were doing Pushpin Studios, and I found myself having lunch with these two, and they were, you know, beyond idols for us in our art school, and there I'm sitting there trying to casually shoot the shit with them, so to speak, and just in awe, and then they did hire me for a couple jobs, which I was thrilled to. So I don't know. That was, you know, you got to come to New York. It's at that, you just had to. It was just, you had to get in the thick of it. You had to see if you had what it took. And anyway, anything else?
Hey, Peter, why don't you tell us a little bit, just however long you want, about the surfing obsession. What keeps you going back? What is it with surfing?
You know, this isn't my thought, but I remember I read once where I go, I feel like I'm a better human being when everything clicks surfing-wise. I made that shirt right there, Bill's wearing shirt saying, out of the water, I'm nothing. But when everything clicks and you're on a good wave and you're surfing it well, whatever, you get kind of a, it's just so satisfying and it's so exhilarating and it's challenging and it's just a, I don't know, this is a great thing to do in your life if you can do it, if you can, you know, stay fit enough to do it. It's obvious I'm getting up there, but I'm going on a trip tomorrow to southern New Mexico, and I don't know, you get the stoke. I don't have to do it like 8 hours a day, but I just want a good session and have that sort of feeling afterwards. I know it sounds ridiculous, it's hokey, but surfers, there's something that's making fanatics out of a lot of people. So, I don't know, what do you think? Why do you?
This is your show.
All right. Yes.
Do you get the same, when you're talking about surfing and the passion, that just want to have a good session, do you feel that way about art as well?
I really, really love the challenge of it, and I never can get good enough, I feel, and there's always like, there's just more. I can do this better. To get that one good piece out of you, like when it all comes together, it's like, I'm just like those shows before the shows. I'm just miserable to be around, as Art knows. And you know, you get like two or three in a row where you know there's magic's got to happen for something. You can't just like put something down and go, here it is. It's got its, you know, because I've done pieces and then I try to do like another piece. I go, oh, this one sold. I'm going to make another one. And that one just, it's just, your heart isn't into it like it is. So
it's like surfing, isn't it?
It is. You got to. All cylinders have to be firing. You can't do it half-assed or casually. You have to, I do. I still you know, rings my chimes, whatever you want to say. It's the challenge. It's a lifelong thing. Okay, let's have our beverages, right?
Yes, and please join us.
Yeah.
Thank you
for coming.